the international voice of world evangelism, bringing to you the revelation of Jesus Christ. Welcome to this production by Jesus Christ, Eternal Kingdom of Abundant Life. Journey with us back through the barriers of time and join with the children of God who have entered into the spiritual world of the mind of Christ, brought forth through the inspired Word of God. We now present the everlasting gospel of Jesus Christ, brought forth by our beloved brother, Reverend George Leon Pike. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ, the international voice of world evangelism, the only complete God-sent message sounding forth in the world today, which is essential for your salvation and translation into the marvelous kingdom of our God. The scriptures tell us to have faith in God, to let him that hath an ear hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And now, let us draw nigh with a pure heart in full assurance of faith, as our beloved brother, internationally known evangelist, teacher, and writer, Reverend George L. Pike, opens to our hearts the mystery of God.
Hello, friends. I'd like to take a few moments of your time to introduce you to a new way of life called the revelation of Jesus Christ. My name is George Pike, and I'm a minister of the gospel of the Lord Jesus. It's been my happy privilege for many years to travel across the beautiful land of America and into the foreign countries testifying the gospel of Christ. Our ministry has been greatly blessed of God, and we have been able to go out among millions of people by radio, television, and by the printed page. Our ministry is in something like 30 foreign languages, and we would like to extend to you a hearty invitation to join us in our Christian endeavors for Christ. We'd like to invite you today to listen to our program and be partakers with us in the benefit of Christ in what we're trying to do in our world crusades. This time we'd like to introduce you to a group of our singers called the Joyful Heavenlies. We have part of them with us today, and they're going to sing for your pleasure today. Thank you.
Christ within you. Your living here will be in vain. There'll come a time when death shall call you. Riches cannot help you then. So come to Jesus, for only He can satisfy. And only Jesus can satisfy your soul. And only He can change your life and make it whole. He'll give you peace you never knew, sweet love and joy, and heaven too. For only Jesus can satisfy your soul. And only Jesus can satisfy your soul. And only He can change your life and make you whole. He'll give you peace you never knew.
Well, praise the Lord for the singing. I hope that it has inspired your hearts. Now we come to the important part of our program, the ministering of the Word. And here's Brother George Pike to minister unto you.
So happy privilege to be back again today and have the opportunity to talk to you about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Reading today from the 3rd chapter of the book of Matthew, the 13th verse, "Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, Thus suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him." You know, there's one thing that we need to remember as Christians, and that is, it is our job, or our privilege, as we would say, through life, to fulfill all righteousness. The thing that God wants us to do is to fulfill all righteousness. If everybody could come to one understanding in Christianity, and that is that it is their place in life to fulfill all righteousness, then we would have a wonderful Christian world to live in. But as long as we have so many different opinions and ideas about things, and as long as one believes that he is right and another believes that he is right, then we're going to have problems. We're never going to have the unified endeavor that God would have us to have toward his great kingdom. You know, what we need to do is come together as one great unit, one great religious body, believing just one thing, and that is what the Holy Scriptures teach us. And then when we do this, we all can rejoice in God and have a wonderful place in the body of Christ. We can see the Lord work His marvelous will in our lives and bring us health and happiness. We'll be able to understand better what God has in store for us when we come to the place to where we can fulfill all righteousness. The one thing about Jesus that was so outstanding, Him being our example as He walked this earth, the one thing so outstanding about Jesus was that He wanted to do the Father's will. You know, the question arises many times in our hearts and among us. The question comes up, what is the will of God? But there's one thing that we understand, and that is that God's Word is His will. The Bible tells us in one place that Jesus speaking said, "Lo, I come in the volume of the book, as it is written of me, O God, to do thy will." And the one thing that Jesus was interested in as he walked the shores of Galilee, that was to do the will of God. He said, "I do always the things that please my Father. I do always the things that I see my Father do." And you know, the secret of Enoch was, just before his translation, it was that he did always the things that pleased God. The Bible said, for before his translation, he had this testimony, and that is that he pleased God. That's what we need to do, is to please God. The scriptures tell us that without faith it is impossible for us to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and believe that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I believe that if all of us could come together with the Word of God, learn the Word of God, understand the Word of God, and accept nothing but the Word of God, I believe that all of our differences and all of our disputes could be settled, and we could be one great body of believers that love the Lord Jesus. But there's one thing that we must remember that the Scripture teaches, and that is we must fulfill all righteousness. We must remember that God's plan in our lives and in our hearts is that we fulfill all righteousness. We can't deviate from the Word of God. We can't take shortcuts. We can't just get something in our mind and feel like that because we have this conviction that God will suffer it, or because we see it this way that God is going to work with us in that conviction. We cannot do that. We must take some guideline. We must have some foundation, some absolute in life. See, God requires that we have some absolute, some foundation or guideline for our Christianity. If we just go by our feelings, men are full of feelings. If we go by our opinions and our ideas, men are full of ideas. And their heart is filled with different opinions. So then we could never come together like that. We could never please God like that. But see, we've got to remember the whole program is God's program. And if it's God's program, then we ought to do what God tells us about it. And we've got to remember that God's Word is here in the earth for us, that we should learn it, read it, understand it, and obey it. And God's Word isn't hard to understand. I know that men take different ideas about the interpretation of God's Word, and they want to split, as we would say, theological hairs over certain things in God's Word. But you know, really and truly, the Word of God is very simple and very easy to understand when it comes to serving God or when it comes to righteousness. I'm well aware of the fact that there's many mysteries in the Word of God. There are many mysteries, and the Bible tells us that it is given unto you and I to understand the mysteries of God. I realize that. And Paul said, great is the mystery of godliness, and I'm made a steward of the mysteries of God. But we're speaking principally of righteousness, just honoring God with our daily efforts, and honoring God with our daily speech, and honoring God with our daily thoughts. See the simplicity of Christ in humanity. It is so very simple when it comes to serving God and understanding God and living a holy, clean, right, upright life, as we would say. God wants us to be a clean person, a pure, virtuous person. You know, one of the great secrets of Jesus in the divine deliverance that he possessed in his life was that he, as he walked this earth, possessed great virtue. He had great virtues. You know, the thing that Satan is driving at in the world today, he's driving in such a manner that he wants to completely eradicate all of the virtues of mankind. His ultimatum in life is to completely take away all of our virtues, to strip us of all of the virtues. See, God is a Holy Spirit. The Bible tells us he is the great, wonderful Holy Spirit, the great fountain of life, God upon which everything depends, God who depends upon nothing. See, and God is the spirit of virtue. And as long as we are filled with virtues, then God can fellowship us. Paul the great apostle one time made the statement in his writings. He said, follow after that which causes us to be filled with virtue. If anything has any virtue in it, Paul said, think on these. And see, what we need to do is let our minds feed upon things that are holy and virtuous and pure and beautiful in the spirit and the kingdom of God. So then, virtue gives life. The devil would like to just take all of the virtues out of life, because if he can take away my virtue and your virtue, the virtue of the women, the virtue of the young girls, the virtue of our men and boys, and the virtue of our daily activities and social affairs, then he knows that God can't have any place in our life. But as long as we have virtues, then God can fellowship us, because God is the great spirit of virtue. That was the secret of Jesus. Jesus was filled with virtue. Always with the great virtue of God, Jesus was filled with it. When people needed healing, they would press in through the crowd to get to Jesus. The reason for that is because Jesus had virtue. Jesus would pray all night. Jesus would fast many times, do without his meals, because he wanted to fill his body with the virtues of God. On numbers of occasions, the Bible speaks of being filled with the Spirit, filled with the virtue of God. Because Jesus, though he was a man, yet because he was filled with the virtue of God, there was divine deliverance that was continually taking place as he walked the earth. And on many occasions, people would push through the crowds, and they'd try to get near Jesus, like the little woman. As she came near him, she purposed in her heart, if she could just but touch the hem of his garment, that something would happen to her. And if you'll notice the statement that Jesus made, by that you can tell what healed the little woman. See, when the little woman got near Jesus, her faith went out to God, and she touched the hem of his garment. And when she did, Jesus turned and said, "Somebody touch me." And the disciples, they turned and they thought within themselves, "Why, there's many people touching him. What do you mean, Master, that somebody touched you? Well, there's people touching you all around." But Jesus said, not like this touch. This was a different touch altogether. This was a touch that had reached beyond the veil of flesh. This was an act of faith, something that had gone up into the heavenlies, gone beyond the veil of humanity, and reached over into the supernatural world. A great move of God that had took place in the simple little heart of a suffering woman. But Jesus said, "Somebody touch me. Somebody touch me." And this is the way he expressed himself. He said, "I know that somebody touched me because I felt virtue go out of my body." The Bible said the little woman felt within herself that she was healed. She felt that virtue. She felt the virtues of God as it flowed through the body of the Lord Jesus and came over to her suffering body. And she believed, and she was made whole because of the virtue. See, the Bible tells us that Jesus was filled with the virtues of God. And when people could get near Jesus, they would find healing. They would find deliverance. Think what it would be like today if we would follow in the steps of Jesus and we'd just be filled with the virtues of God. And our mind was daily upon suffering humanity and the need of the world. And that we didn't have any plans in life except just to please Christ, to see God's kingdom established in the earth. You know, the establishing of God's kingdom in the earth means healing for the suffering. It means deliverance. It means sight to the blind. It means the deaf will be able to hear again. And the lame will be able to walk. All the poverties of earth will be taken away. See, just by the kingdom of God being in the earth. And so then, we understand that when we say virtue, we're speaking of restoring the virtues. Look at the day that we're living in. See, all of the virtues are being taken out of the earth. That's why there's so much sickness. That's why there's so much sorrow. How can we turn it around? How can we change it? By fulfilling all righteousness. When we start fulfilling righteousness, we start thinking on holy things. When we start doing that's right, talking right, our conversation, we begin to let it be holy. And then when we begin to dress as holy people, as the women of old and the men of old in modest apparel, when we begin to make our daily living a holy, upright life before God, when we, whether merchants or whatever it might be, begin to have our business transactions in such a way that we're careful not to shortchange anybody through life, not to try to take advantage of someone, but to deal truthfully with them, not to have false balances, but to do right. We who are leaders in the world, when we come together with one mind and one accord, that one mind is to fulfill all righteousness, then God is going to step down in our midst. God, the great eternal Spirit, is going to move into our midst, and we're going to feel great relief from the stress and strain of life. We're going to see the hippies turn away from all the dope that they use trying to find peace. We're going to see the teenagers lose all of this restlessness and simmer down and begin to find rest again. We're going to find mothers and daddies turning away from the bars and all of those things of life that's so detrimental to life and to the soul. We're going to see families reunited again, happiness and joy and peace. We'll see the lame walk, the deaf will be made to hear, and the blind will be able to see. All because the great virtue of God will be restored in life and be restored to the human heart and to mankind. This is what we believe. This is what we teach. This is what we stand for. And I believe today that if all of us would be of one mind, whereas the Bible tells us to be of one mind and one accord, if we could be of just one mind, and that would be the mind of Christ, just one accord, and that accord would be to do the will of God. If we could do that, friend, what a wonderful world it would be. What a wonderful family in the earth it would be. All of us would be healthy, happy, prosperous, and everything would be well with you and with me and our families. It's been wonderful just to have a few minutes to talk with you today. It's always a grand and a glorious privilege just to have a chance to talk with you and let you know how we feel, to be able to encourage your heart and tell you what we would like for you to have in your life concerning the benefits of Christ. We'd like for you to pray with us as we pray today. I'd like to pray for you as always, asking God to heal you, asking God to help you. Prayer means everything. Prayer changes things. And there is no distance in prayer. When we pray in faith believing, something has got to take place. I'd like for you to bow your heads with me in reverence to the great eternal Spirit, the Spirit of God, which is right there with you and right here with me. Let us all pray together as we ask God to bless us. Father, Lord of heaven, as we lift up holy hands, Father, made holy by the blood of the Son of God, dear God, we're so thankful because we feel that quickening Spirit. Holy Father, we feel the love that's so near us, God, and that great power of heaven, Lord, that is present with us, that great, wonderful, wooing virtue, Lord, that heals, oh God, that I feel right now, that Spirit of God, Lord, that resurrected Christ Jesus from the dead, that made the blind to see. Oh God, that made the lame to walk, that made the deaf to hear. That same wonderful Spirit, God, that has been throughout the endless ages, and God that will be here throughout eternity. Father, we pray that right now, that whoever hears these words, Father, that they will believe, whoever understands these things that we're saying, Father, that at this moment that they'll receive these words. And Father of heaven, in the name of your lovely Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, stretch out your hand, Father. Stretch out your hand, and through your great power, Father, through your great wonderful presence, Father, forgive our sins. Save souls, God, and heal sick bodies. I ask you to do it right now. Heal in the name of Jesus, Father. Heal and set free. Heal right now. I feel you doing it in the name of Jesus. I ask it in Jesus' name, Father, and for your glory. We want to say that it's been a real privilege to talk with you. We trust that something has been said today that may prove to be a great benefit to you. When you have a chance, we'd like for you to write us, visit with us, come in. Spend some time with us. We'd like to counsel with you. We'd like to talk to you about Jesus. We'd like to hear from you because we're concerned about you. For this reason, we come to you from time to time by means of radio and TV and the printed page, trying to get into your heart and into your home for no other reason than to give you strength, health, and happiness for the coming seasons. May the Lord bless you is our prayer.
Well, friends, that's all the time we have for today's broadcast. And we know that if you've watched this program with an open heart and mind, the understanding and love of God has been shed abroad in your heart. Let me encourage you to write us a letter. It thrills our hearts to hear what God has done for you in your life. When you write, be sure to ask for our tapes and literature. We have printed literature available in over 50 different foreign languages, as well as Braille for the blind. We also have sermon booklets, cassette tapes, and song sheets. All of our tapes and literature are Post Office Box 986, Monroe, Georgia, 30655, USA. That address again is Jesus Christ Eternal Abundant Life Incorporated, Post Office Box 986, Monroe, Georgia, 30655, USA. And until next time, may God richly bless you.